Hello everyone, really glad to be with all of you here today. And I'll be speaking on a short summary of the ideas of decolonizing science, a topic which has been much in the news, and there have been a large number of debates on this across continents, particularly from Africa, South America, parts of Asia and so on. So what I want to do is to start with the basic idea of what do these people mean by decolonizing science, and then I want to look at certain arguments and critiques of it, and finally end with offering a particular model for decolonizing science so that we understand this not just as a rhetorical political claim but as something which is very pragmatic and doable. Now to summarize a very long narrative about decolonization, if we very quickly want to summarize what it means, you could say that primarily what we mean by decolonization is a critique of the dominance of knowledge, not just in particular kinds of disciplines like philosophy, science, arts, social science and humanities and so on, but it extends across a wide variety of human action, on social action, which includes practices of medicine, narratives of understanding the world, conceptual structures which are present in different cultures. And along with this critique of the dominance of this structure, of what is often called as Western epistemologies, there is an attempt to replace them with indigenous knowledge systems and practices. And that is also the part of the problem, because there's a lot of contention on what would constitute indigenous and whether the indigenous is meaningful in the contemporary context. So I will address this particular question later on in the talk. Specifically, it has been a call to replace the hegemony of Western systems. So much of the movement for decolonization has happened in universities in South Africa, South America, Asia, and so on. And there, the argument is that you want to build a university system, teach a system of knowledge and disciplines which inculcate the various practices of local cultures and non-Western hegemonic systems. So it is also a recognition, as scholars in decolonization suggest, that it is also a recognition that the Eurocentric model is not universal. And of course, for those of you in Europe, you might think that this is a question which is really not of concern to you, because it seems to be more a reaction from the non-Europe, non-Western societies, which feel that the Eurocentric model has been dominant and that for their societies, you need to articulate different kinds of models. And therefore, the idea of decolonization has spread across, not just from looking at specific medical traditions or what kind of knowledge systems are present between different communities within a society, but it has spread across to almost everything in modern practice today, from university changing, decolonizing universities, decolonizing curriculum, decolonizing how we teach, decolonizing libraries, which is a very interesting move, where people have been arguing that the kind of books which a library decides to buy and stock and thereby protect has to be questioned, because as we know, libraries have to make a choice of deciding what texts to actually buy. And how do they make that choice? What decides what is their canon? What decides, who decides these are the kind of books our students should read? And typically, if you find in many of these non-Western societies, that the libraries often tend to ignore many of the important pioneering writings produced by their own societies. So the decolonization of library is, I think, an extremely important part of the movement of decolonization. There have been calls to decolonize methodology, the way in which we do things, including science and mathematics and so on, aims of research, ideas of progress, etc. So it's very vast. It is moved across various domains in order to keep alerting people to the fact that what we receive in the name of knowledge may actually be hegemonical, and communities and societies have not thought enough about the knowledge they receive and transmit. And as part of it, people have been, as a counter to this, to show a positive program rather than just a critical program of decolonization, is to look at indigenous knowledge systems in various, related to various examples and for various disciplines, various concepts, and how nature has been understood differently, origin of universe stories, narratives from many indigenous communities, how different communities define what it is to be human, and how that idea can become part of a global discourse on what it is to be human. The kind of anger which sometimes speaks through the decolonization discourse is one which is, which is an anger at the fact that very important ideas about the nature of human, our relationship to the world, ideas of knowledge, have not become part of the global knowledge system. And without any reason, and it's not that people have looked at these knowledge systems and said, this doesn't work, I think this is wrong. It's actually this kind of ignoring this whole system, systematic, ignoring this particular kinds of knowledge systems, which really is a specific problem. And when people have responded to this by saying, what kind of indigenous knowledge systems or non-Western knowledge systems are present, there have been many cases which have been shown. And if you look at the literature, you'll find very rich work on indigenous mathematics, because mathematics is a central question in the science and mathematics. I'll come to that a bit later. There have been very, very good accounts of ethnomathematics, medical knowledge, of course, from all over the world, metallurgy, chemistry, and so on. Then, as an extension of this, there has been an idea proposed, which some of you would know about, particularly with the African scholar Mbembe and the South American scholar Mignolo, of the idea of promoting an idea of pluriversity and not university. And I think the crucial point to note here is that, as Mbembe points out, by pluriversity, we are really talking about a system of education, a system of knowledge, which is open to epistemic diversity. And I'll very quickly talk a little bit about what that could mean. And again, Mignolo is also, echoing parts of it by saying a pluriverse of multi-realities. Multi-realities is because, different people have had different ways of understanding the world, understanding what progress means, what development means, and so on. So first, let me give you some arguments for decolonization, okay? And then I'll give you a critique of decolonization, so then we can see what we can do with it. Now, first of all, the importance of decolonization is because it offers a knowledge of the local context. So you would not be surprised, or some of you would be surprised to know, that if you look at what the university curriculum would be in many parts of Asia and Africa, much of it seems to be irrelevant to the kinds of social problems, the kinds of social context, the conceptual world of the people who live in those societies. And none of them become part of a university system, because in the guise of a global university system and global knowledge practices, there has been a complete erasure of a very large number of population of the world, their conceptual understanding, their way of making sense of their lives, and so on. So that is one very important reason why, and that's how the question of epistemic diversity comes. It's a very important reason why we need to take decolonization seriously. There is also decolonization is also a way to set right the wrong history of intellectual traditions, because, there have been so many, and I can speak on philosophy, which is my discipline, that the kind of histories of philosophy which are taught are shocking to me when I look at the kind of texts and the kind of deep philosophical meditation in many cultures, other than a small group of European communities which have produced what we see as dominant practice of Western philosophy today. So one of the important reasons for this decolonization project has also been to set right the wrong history of intellectual traditions, how ideas have progressed, how ideas have moved across cultures, and so on. And it is also a reaction and setting right the colonial rejection of the epistemology of the colonized. In colonial discourse of the colonized, the way in which the colonials construct what knowledge was present in the colonized countries is again something which you'll have to read to really understand, to really understand the depth of their kind of contempt for knowledge system of other cultures. So how does one respond to that?
To continue watching this video, click the link in the top left or in the description below. Or visit iai.tv for more debates and talks from the world's leading thinkers on today's biggest ideas.